Hello everyone, this is the April 20th recording for BU 655 Financial Strategies. In this video, I'm going to go through the answer key for the assignment that is due this evening and also go through your assignment, your shorter assignment for next week, which takes the place of the group work that you would normally do if we were holding class in person. So your assignment for this week was to go through this spreadsheet, and let me go ahead and pull that up. The assignment up here. Here we go. So the first thing in the assignment titled Should Lazy Boy Take on Debt? Understand that Lazy Boy historically has not had debt or interest-bearing debt on their financial statement. And so the question here is, should they be taking on debt? So let's take a look at the first question here. Complete the Lazy Boy Information Excel worksheet. So we're going to take a look at that. So I've given you the information here, fairly up-to-date information. The stock price of the company is $32.80 when I made this assignment up. This was the number of shares outstanding. The market cap was about $1.5 billion. The total value of their assets was a little over $1 billion, and their effective tax rate, which by the way is not the marginal tax rate, but the effective tax rate is 26.42%. Okay, so you should have completed this table here. The interest expense is just calculated taking the amount of debt multiplied by the pre-tax cost of debt, or the required rate of return on that, by the bondholders. Then the shares repurchased is equal to the stock price, is equal to the debt amount divided by the stock price. You can see here as we take on more debt, the number of shares repurchased goes up, the number of shares remaining after repurchase goes down, and then our break-even EBIT looks like this. For taking out an amount of debt of $350 million, they needed to have at least an expectation of an EBIT of $76.5 million. For $750 million in debt, they needed to have a break-even EBIT of around $115 million. And then finally, for $1.15 billion in debt, Lazy Boy needed to have a break-even EBIT of $138 million approximately. Down here I've got the EBIT, earnings before interest and taxes, for the past five fiscal years for Lazy Boy. You can see it went up between 2015 and 2017, went down very slightly in 2018, and then continued to go down in 2019. The median of the last 5 years was $123 million. The average was $123 million, the median was $128 million. And so what I ask you to do is assume that the company is going to have $125 million in EBIT in the next year when considering the different levels of debt. So we have the EBIT here of $125 million. I put that in there for you. The interest expense comes from our first table up here. Then we get the EBT, or earnings before taxes, by taking the EBIT minus the interest expense. Our income taxes then are 26.42% of our earnings before taxes. Net income is $91,947,250 for zero debt, and then you can see it goes down as we increase the debt because the interest expense is increasing. Our earnings per share for each level of debt should look like this: $1.97 per share for zero debt, $2.20 per share for $350 million in debt, $2.13 for $750 million in debt, and then $0.73 per share for $1.15 million in debt. Then finally, we have a table of the cash flows to calculate the interest tax shield. So in the first column, there is no interest tax shield because there's no debt. All money goes to the stockholders, assuming that all net income is being paid out. Then as we add debt, we have an interest tax shield because the interest expense is deductible for tax purposes. and that goes up as we take on more and more debt. So let's take a look at the questions, and I'll post this out online too. The first question: list two things that are mentioned in the Lazy Boy Value Line report that should improve the profitability of the firm in the future. So let's open up that report. So they say in the Value Line report here that high margin sales gains should help boost profitability. The upholstery market has stabilized. The housing market strength may be improved. An easing of trade tensions, all these things you might consider to improve profitability. The question, which isn't really laid out much in here other than this last paragraph, about the current coronavirus issues that we're facing and how that might affect the stock of Lazy Boy whenever there are new housing sales, the demand for Lazy Boy's products tend to go up. So, and also, you know, in the back of my mind, I'm thinking people sitting around now a lot more, spending more time inside, they might want a more comfortable chair. They might be wearing out their chairs or their sofas or what, all the other things that Lazy Boy sells. So there might be some pickup in demand there. We can look at over here at this estimated growth rate. We talked about, you know, is $125 million, that's one of the questions, an accurate or achievable goal for earnings or earnings before interest and taxes. And we see here the analysts expect earnings to grow over the next 5 years an average of 9% a year. So from my point of view, I think that's a reasonable guess to make. However, it's okay if you disagree with that. Just put it in your paper there. The next question is, according to the home furnishings industry value line report, what is the state of the U.S. market for the building products industry? What development is expected to have a positive impact on overall growth for the industry? So going back out here to the industry, so this report says that the industry remains largely a robust sector of the economy with strong growth prospects. And what development is expected to have an overall positive impact on overall market growth for the industry? So here it talks about the growing number of renovation and modification projects and the rising focus on the development of infrastructure and real estate in China and India have increased the demand for furniture and furnishings. The rise of e-commerce and broader market presence of the internet have become integral aspects of the organized retail sector. People are increasingly ordering home furnishings online. And so these really are two drivers of estimated growth at a 13% compound annual growth rate over the next few years. So those would definitely be what we would be looking for. So as developments for the industry. Do you think the assumption used in the Excel worksheet of an EBIT of $125 million is reasonable? Why or why not? And I showed you the Value Line statement and also the industry statement. We don't really know what's going to go on with the coronavirus and the demand for products like those sold by Lazy Boy. However, it appears based on the information in those documents that the $125 million is very reasonable in terms of an EBIT. But if you put down that it's not, all I'm looking for there really is why you know, give me a good reason why you feel it's not a good estimate. Number four, review the source of business risk from the capital structure notes. Based on the information provided in the articles, which of the sources of business risk provided from the notes are important for Lazy Boy? So those, you know, those risks included the cost of inputs, the cost of outputs or the volatility of output prices, The ability to change output prices based on the cost of inputs, operating leverage risk, operating leverage risk, and foreign exposure risk. So, again, I'm just looking for you to grab a couple of those and explain why you think that those business risks apply specifically to Lazy Boy. The industry document that we looked at did specifically, cite growth in China and India. And so that could certainly lead to some foreign exposure risk. The last question says, of the four levels of debt, including no debt, that Lazy Boy is considering per the Excel worksheet, which one do you think that Lazy Boy should pursue? Explain your answer. And so in this case, there is certainly a wrong answer. The wrong answer would be the top one here, because the break-even EBIT is greater than what we expect or our assumption for the EBIT in the coming future. And really, as volatile as things are right now, I would probably not want to go that far out, put the company that far out and make it that risky. Zero debt really doesn't offer any benefits, and there are certainly benefits to adding on debt. In fact, what Lazy Boy has done, which is not accounted for in here, is they haven't taken out debt, but they've taken out capital leases, which are often treated as debt in the amount of about $358 million. So they've actually gone with around this level of debt, this $350 million worth of debt. The value of the firm to the stockholder is maximized at that $350 million because it has the highest earnings per share. You could also make the case for the $750 million because the greatest interest tax shield is provided here at the $1.51 billion. However, that one requires too much EBIT to break even. And so the $750 million provides a higher interest tax shield than the $350 million. So I think either one of these would be acceptable. I would probably pick $350 million because it does increase, it maximizes the earnings per share based on the different options that we have here. Please let me know if you have any questions about the assignment and about the how to answer the questions for this assignment. Let me move on then to your assignment for next week. So your assignment for next week is under Capital Structure Supplemental Assignment. And for this assignment, I use spreadsheets from Aswath Damodaran's website. I'll just show it to you here. It's at pages.stern.nyu.edu/, I don't know what that's called, the curly symbol there, A Damodar, A-D-A-M-O-D-A-R. It's Aswath Damodaran or Damodaran Online. He's a very well-known and well-respected finance professor at Stern School of Business at New York University. He puts out a lot of information, a lot of free information, so it's nice on a lot of different things like valuation and investing and data sources on industries. And so I've used some of this information, and it's fairly up to date. He refreshed this information in January of 2020. And I altered the spreadsheets he put out there a little bit. Actually, let me go back here. So, capital structure supplemental work. So, I've taken this real information that Aswath Damodaran puts out online, and I've converted it a little bit to make it a little more manageable. What I want you to see from this is really how, in real life, how companies and companies within specific industries, how their capital structure works, and why different industries might have different capital structures. So the instructions here are, please use the Excel workbook to answer the questions in this assignment and turn in your answers by 5:30 p.m. on Monday, April 27th. Please do let me know if you have any questions about the material in the assignment or the workbooks. I added a second workbook since I wrote this up and put it out online. The information from the workbooks, sorry about that, were taken from the website of Aswath Damodaran. And again, here's his website. There are many different industries included in the workbook. Two of them you may have questions about are the following. REITs are REITs. their real estate investment trust, and that those are companies that own and in most cases operate income producing real estate. So for example, I don't know if it still does because it's changed hands, but the Westridge Mall here in Topeka was owned by, I believe, I could be wrong about this, but Simon Properties. Simon Properties actually constructs, is its own company, but it also constructs REITs. And so you could purchase a real estate investment trust, ownership in a real estate investment trust through the stock market, that essentially its assets consist of things like malls, shopping malls, and your cash flows as the investor, as the stockholder in these, occur whenever the tenants of these malls pay their payments in, and so the mall pays its expenses, and then you as a stockholder get the rest of the money that's left over. And so that's what a REIT is. It's, you know, the real estate investment trust takes a several different properties and sells off ownership in those properties to the investors. And then as cash flows come in, as rents come in, those investors are paid off. And they REITs have limited lifespans, unlike other equity investments. And they also, as I have in here, 100% payout. So the assets, you know, backing up that repayment are the malls themselves as that real estate. Financial services, non-bank and insurance, and this title is somewhat misleading. I went with the title that was already in there, though. So a lot of these companies are financial holding companies, which consist of, so it's a holding company that consists of things like a commercial bank, what you would regularly go to for your banking needs, insurance companies, mortgage companies, investments companies, all bundled up into one financial holding company. So this also includes companies like Discover. So if you have a Discover card, it's the company that provides those cards. So credit card companies like that. And then things like Standard & Poor's is also included in this. And also NASDAQ, which is an exchange, but also its own company. It has a ticker symbol of QQQ. So kind of a variety of financial companies. However, a lot of them are things like financial holding companies or non-depository lenders, such as a Discover credit card. Retail special lines, I looked at that and said, you know, what is special lines? So, and I'll show you another spreadsheet here that includes all of the companies used to make up the industry in the workbook. This industry generally consists of stores that specialize in a specific area, such as Build-A-Bear, GameStop, Foot Locker, Kato. Kato's a clothing company. And so that is, they're specialty retailers, not like a Walmart or, you know, a JCPenney would not be included in that. All right, so for the assignment, each question is worth 2.5 points. And there's four questions that I'd like you to answer for next week, what you're going to turn in. First is, which industry has the lowest book debt to capital and market debt to capital ratios? It's the same industry. Why are firms in this industry bad candidates for debt? So think about what makes up the value for these firms. What would make up the market value of the firm? What are the types of assets that firms in this industry have? And if you have questions about that, I'm happy to answer and give you a list of firms. I'll also show you where you can find those too. Why do REIT firms have such high book debt to capital and market debt to capital ratios? Again, think about the assets that are backing up this firm and the value of those assets and what they're like. From the correlation matrix, what is the relationship between the debt ratios and the effective tax rate? Based on our notes from our last lecture, why would that relationship exist? And then finally, from the correlation matrix, what is the relationship between the debt ratios and the standard deviation in stock prices? All right, so let's look at these workbooks real quick. So the first one, and it just says DBT fund, it's debt fundamentals. I've got some variable definitions. These explain what each of the lines mean, or each of the columns mean in the next table. These are the industry averages for the firms within these industries. So you can see the industries I selected for this were based on the number of firms within that industry. Some of the industries have very few firms, and I left those out because they're not really trustworthy in terms of the averages you're going to get there. So I've got all the different industries here that I want you to take a look at, and you can sort these, the entire table, just by pressing down on this and tell it to sort. So for example, you know, I can sort from the largest firms in terms of book to debt capital, and those also are all the largest firms in terms of market debt to capital versus the smallest for those, and really any of the other variables here, I can do that. Then finally, the correlation matrix. This gives the correlation coefficient for each of the variables. So for example, firms with high debt to capital also have high market debt to capital, so that's not surprising. There's a negative correlation between capital spending divided by total assets and book debt to capital, and so on. And the questions I have for you have to do with the effective tax rate and the standard deviation in stock prices. So that's the first workbook. The second workbook is one I took off, and that comes from Dama Darren's website, but I took out a lot of the information, so you focus on just a few industries there. This one here, if you have questions about the industry, again, I'm happy to answer those. But you can also look up the industry group on here and see, and I've alphabetized them based on the industry group. So the first one is advertising. And you'll notice there's a lot of industry groups on this page that aren't on the pages I've given you, because again, I took out ones that were had few representatives. I also took out banks. We generally don't include banks in a lot of our analyses because they're really strange in terms of capital structure and in terms of regulation. But you can search for different industries and see the components of that industry for the United States on this page, and then you can also look at global, all over the world, emerging markets, Japan, Europe, Australia, and so on these other tabs if you're interested in doing that. So that is your assignment for next week. The following week, it's going to be a long lecture on valuation and mergers and acquisitions, and then you'll do a case study, complete a case study on Renaissance Learning. It's a company that was eventually acquired, but it's kind of an interesting story. At least I think it's interesting, and so I'm looking forward to having you work through that and read that case. Then after that is going to be the last thing for the class is the final exam. It'll be similar to what your midterm was, because it's a stay-at-home exam. I'll give you plenty of time to do it, probably at least a week to complete it, and I'll be getting that out to you in the next couple weeks. All right. So I have a good week. Again, as you're working through this assignment or as you're looking at your assignment you're turning in for this evening, please let me know if you have any questions, and I take care and stay well.